So, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the annual meeting of the stockholders of Applied DNA Sciences. We thank you all for coming. I am James Hayward, Chairman, President, and Chief Executive Officer of the company, and I will act as chair of the formal portion of this meeting. I would like to introduce you to the directors and members of management who are present with us at this meeting. We're very pleased to have with us the following directors: John Bitzer, Bob Cattell, Joe Ciccoli, Yaacov Shamash, and Sandy Simon. Unfortunately, Charles Ryan could not be here with us today. We're pleased to have from the management team Beth Jantzen, our CFO, Ben Liang, our secretary, Judy Murrah, our CIO, Debbie Bailey, our Executive Director of Investor Relations, and a number of colleagues who you have hopefully had an opportunity to speak with today. Our founding partner, John Heelshorn of LHA, which is Applied DNA's investor relations firm, Jim LaRocca of Marcum LLP, our independent certified public accountants, and Merrill Cranes of Pepper Hamilton, our legal counsel. With this, the meeting will please come to order. Jed Blavitt, a representative of Broadridge Financial Solutions, will serve as the inspector of elections for this meeting, with authority, among other things, to receive and determine the validity of all proxies and ballots submitted and to certify the number of shares represented at this meeting and the results of the vote of the company's stockholders on any motion. Ms. Debbie Bailey will act as secretary of the meeting, and I will now turn the floor over to her.
Thank you, Jim. Mr. Blavitt has taken and signed an oath to faithfully execute the duties of inspector of elections with strict impartiality and according to the best of his ability. The floor recognizes Mr. Lavitt.
I present the affidavit of Broadridge Financial Solutions, the company's mailing and tabulating agent, with respect to the due mailing of the notice of internet availability of proxy materials to stockholders of the company, as well as the due mailing of the notice of the meeting, the proxy statement, and the form of proxy to those stockholders requesting it. I also present a list of the holders of the company's common stock as of the close of business on January 9th, 2017, the record date for this meeting, as prepared by American Stock Transfer and Trust Company.
The affidavits, proxy materials, and list of stockholders are directed to be filed with the records of the company. Is there anyone here who wants to vote today, or has everyone already voted? Okay, good.
The registrar has computed the number of shares represented under the official form of proxy made available or sent to stockholders, to which I have added the number of shares present in person at this meeting. I report that the holders of at least 19,889,356 shares of common stock are represented at the meeting, which shares represent approximately 74.47% of the shares entitled to vote at the meeting.
The quorum is therefore present, and the meeting is properly constituted for the transaction of business. The proxies and any substitutions of proxies presented to the meeting are hereby ordered filed with the records of the company. As set forth in the notice sent to each of the stockholders of the company, the business of this meeting includes the election of 7 persons to the board of directors of the company as presented in Proposal 1 in the proxy statement, and the ratification of the appointment of Marcum LLP as the company's independent registered public accountant
polls are now closed with respect to the proposals. Would you...
Mr. Lavitt, would you please report on the votes taken with respect to proposal number one, the election of directors of the company?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to advise the meeting that with respect to proposal number one, Debbie Bailey, as appointed in the official proxy card, has voted in accordance with the proxies received from stockholders. I report that the nominees who received the highest numbers of affirmative votes of the shares present in person or represented by proxy and entitled to vote, quorum being present, are James A. Hayward, John Bitzer III, Robert B. Cattell, Joseph B. Ciccoli, Charles Ryan, Yaakov Shamash, and Sanford R. Simon.
Mr. Hayward, Bitzer, Cattell, Ciccoli, Ryan, Shamash, and Simon have each been elected as directors of the company. Mr. Lavitt, would you please report on the vote taken with respect to proposal number two, the ratification of the appointment of Markham LLP as the company's independent registered public accounting firm for the fiscal year ending September 30th, 2017?
I would like to advise the meeting that Ms. Bailey has voted in accordance with the proxies received from stockholders. 19,130,231 votes have been cast in favor of proposal number two. 707,782 votes have been cast against it, and 51,343 votes have abstained. With respect to proposal number two, a majority of the outstanding shares of common stock present or represented at the meeting has been cast in favor of the proposal, and the Board of Directors' selection of Markham LLP is hereby ratified.
Proposal number two is adopted. I will now return the floor to Dr. Hayden.
Okay, so all those in favor of, we must now first entertain a motion for adjournment of the formal portion of the meeting. So we need any shareholder to so move. We have a few. And a second? We have a few. Thank you very much, everyone. All those in favor of the motion, please signify their assent by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, please signify their dissent by saying nay. Hearing none, thank you for listening through the legal formalities of the meeting. I'll now give a brief presentation on the company. And actually, that's a lie, because several of us will give a brief presentation on the company. So, thank you all for joining us today. I hope that you have taken the time to visit with our colleagues in the stations all around the room. If you haven't, I urge you to do so afterward so that you can see our products and technologies up close. Several of us will be speaking from the podium today, and we ask that you kindly hold your questions until the end, when we will all be available at this podium. We've entitled our presentation today, Bringing Certainty to Uncertain Times. And that certainly describes just what we do, to keep life real and safe, as our brand promise states. Today, our team will share with you our roadmap forward, and we will provide a sense of where we expect our revenue will come from. Now, the video loop that you were watching as you came into the room provides a historical perspective of the business development on one aspect of our work with six different federal agencies. And most importantly, our steady customer, the Defense Logistics Agency. The brief historical perspective will provide a good jumping off point when we discuss our MilGov business vertical shortly. Now, our safe harbor statement simply says that any forward-looking or speculative statements that are meant to inform our investors of our hopes and intentions should not be taken as statements of fact or definitive outcomes. And staying with the historical perspective for just a moment, our company's technology has evolved along a strategic blueprint that was intended to take us from a toolbox to a genuine platform. And our blueprint has done just that. With every quantum leap shown in the figure above, we acquired new customers and pursued new business verticals. Now our platform includes massive, you'll hear that word a lot, uncopyable molecular libraries that can be infused into complex products that function in harsh environments, even missiles. And they can be recovered on command. The toughest critics, law enforcement and the military, have validated us, including in international courts. We learned how to encrypt data in the form of nucleotide sequences with densities higher than binary code. With the pressure for speed to read tags, we have developed and continue to develop rapid detection methods, rapid read optical marks of our own design, in-field readers, and even in-field forensic identification via small portable PCR devices, some the size of a coffee cup, controlled by a smartphone and web accessible. The world's changing. As the power and relevance of bedside DNA diagnostics continues to evolve, so will our ability to serve our customers on the spot and build new revenues in new applications. Some recent developments complete our platform and empower our capacity to deliver the fix for the two problems on the lips of every Fortune CEO: risk and uncertainty. And we can deliver that fix through commercial ecosystems typified by textiles, pharmaceutics, and the military. The developments are, firstly, the capacity to produce DNA using PCR at absolutely massive, there it is again, scale, more than a million times larger than when PCR is used to analyze DNA. The method flies in the face of traditional DNA manufacturing methods that yield much less pure products at much higher costs. Moreover, since our acquisition of Vandalia, we do this manufacturing under not only the technical conditions required by cotton or fertilizer with huge markets, but when it comes to food or drugs, we can manufacture to meet the demands of the FDA. And when it comes to the FDA, there really is no plan B for our customers, no other way to produce molecular tags that would qualify for FDA approval, leaving us in a very attractive position I will elaborate on later. The second development that enables us to serve large commercial ecosystems is the implementation of our IT platform, which you'll hear at the end of our story, and that we call Digital Day, DNA, which Judy Morrow will discuss in detail. It links DNA as a service with big data gathered from serving massive supply chains and the software that enables our customers to ensure their supply chains are pure. Now, as our platforms evolved, so did our business models. We have three discrete business models that are the revenue drivers for the company. Security is the first market we entered, and our profile in this market is really quite unique. Selling to the cash in transit market provided a path to validation in the courts. Generally, we sell finished product to end users, sometimes through distribution for more efficiency and breadth. Our largest revenue driver in security at this time, and a source of recurring revenues for the company, is the marking of automobiles in Europe. Now, our first customer was a pretty tough negotiator who really knew his business. And so I asked him to join the company, and he is now the managing director of our EMEA business, and he's here to talk with you virtually. I'm pleased to introduce Tony Benson, who, along with Drs. Barbara Brockway and Joe Greenwood, develops and manages our business out of London for Europe, the Middle East, and Africa.
Thank you for the opportunity to update you today on Applied DNA Sciences activities from our small team based in Europe. There are six focal points of our efforts that I would like to share with you. And these are: within our security business, asset marking of vehicles and property, where Scandinavia, through multiple insurance and automobile brands, continues to be very successful for us, with over 2,000 vehicles being marked each month and a further 1,200 vehicles per month to be added in the next few months. Current revenue from asset marking in Europe is over $50,000 per month, rising to $75,000 per month very soon. Sales effort to extend our reach in this area continues. For example, in the last 3 weeks, we have submitted quotations to mark over 2 million components for just one large motor vehicle manufacturer, and this could very easily be the tip of the iceberg. Our colleagues in America have elicited strong interest from law enforcement. The second area of work in security is the inclusion of our signature DNA inside cash protection systems across Europe. This was one of the first markets that Applied DNA started doing business in, and we have remained a very significant player and have started to see it grow over the last quarter. Cash protection highlights the security business model with recurring revenue of off-the-shelf products. Moving to our supply chain business model mentioned by Jim, the next area of work is a tagging of granulated fertilizer, and I'm pleased to say we have found a technical solution to add our molecular tag during mass production. The annual global volume of fertilizer manufactured is more than £400 billion. So even a minor penetration of this market could be significant for us. We are working with our commercial partners to develop this opportunity. And the fourth area, also supply chain related, is in the leather industry, where there is a need for manufacturers and brands to provide their customers with true traceability from farm to shop. We've taken a new and different business development approach to this market. So rather than go to a single client, we have secured the sponsorship of five truly global brands who are each paying a portion of pool costs for us to determine the feasibility of using our technology in this complex supply chain. Again, the market size is very substantial. The annual amount of leather sold globally is 22.9 billion square feet. In Europe, where we are also helping our sector leader, Bob Midlani, to sell our products into the farmer market supply chain. We were very recently invited by a global farmer company to respond to a tender opportunity. To be invited by such a significant player in the farmer industry is, I believe, a great measure of our progress and bodes very well for the future. And lastly, we are expanding our sales efforts into the Middle East and specifically the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Very useful meetings have demonstrated significant interest in this large marketplace, a real need for our products, and we have made some excellent contacts to help grow sales in this area. Thank you for your time.
Now, I know, of course, that Tony is listening, so many thanks to Tony and his team. Of course, we also operate a security business in the U.S., led by Gordon Hope, who recently joined us from Honeywell. And we're very pleased to have Gordon on board. He's a unique hire because analysts wrote to congratulate me for the wisdom we showed in asking him to join us. A good sign. Please spend some time with Gordon at his station on my right, where he can tell you about our latest products. Now, supply chain markets draw on the most comprehensive set of our offerings. We will illustrate their benefit to the global uptake of our platform by considering three industry verticals: military and government, textiles, and pharmaceuticals. Our work with the U.S. government has been extremely rewarding, while at the same time, one of our toughest challenges. Our business model has been to earn development funding first, leading to platform enhancements sold afterward to both government and commercial entities. We've put in the time to climb the learning curve of government language, no small feat, teach the government the language of DNA, and harden our products to meet the demands of even missiles in space. Our longest running supply chain has been with the Defense Logistics Agency, and here to tell you about our experience and our future direction is Janice Maraglia, Vice President for Military and Government Programs. Janice will speak to our opportunities to expand development laterally and vertically within this ecosystem. Janice has managed this vertical magnificently, and I'm pleased to introduce her.
Manage programs. Let's see if I can manage this. We practice with a regular PC like the Apple. Anyway, thank you for coming today. And as Jim said, I'm part of the Government and Military Programs Group. And we're defined by the very nature of who we are, a little differently than some of the colleagues that are represented in the room. So where we are customer focused, we have to look at our customers who are supporting everything in wartime and peacetime, from food to fuel. So the tools that are developed in this room become tools that we can talk to our customers about, regardless of the particular part of government or military that they're in. Having said that, the government purchases about 80% of commercial off-the-shelf items, or COTS items, which means that it's in their best interest to invest in innovations that can be deployed commercially, because that's what they're buying. There used to be a day when they were buying mostly very specialized, customized military items, but now they're buying commercial. That was a movement that was put in place decades ago, and we're seeing it more and more now, which makes what we do across all of the platforms here and in the company very important for this customer base. And it's also why they've invested so much R&D into what we're doing, because we represent universal platforms, platforms where DNA can be introduced and platforms where it can also be authenticated. So the relationship we have in place with DLA has been there since 2009, and it's been a cornerstone relationship. DLA represents us to all of DOD. DOD is the largest employer in the world. DLA, who is their repairable and consumable arm, is moving goods and services at $34 billion a year. It covers everything from pharma to physical security to textiles. Parachutes, flags, which are textiles. So they're using all of our products in different ways, and it's ours to introduce all of this to such a broad audience. So the RIF, which DLA managed for us, or Rapid Innovation Fund, is meant to take what we've done in all of these different programs in the company and now develop them further for rapid innovation in industry. So where we worked with DLA where they were marking certain commodities, now they're looking at how they can take this and adopt it through industry, and they become the entity that authenticates. So the platforms that we had to develop were in tandem, both on the marking and the authentication side. As far as non-DOD, we are working with an agency that we can't get into details about, but we signed a blanket purchase agreement, which was 5 years in length and $2.5 million. We have over 2 years left, and we have over 4 years left and over $2 million to work through on that. And we've been strategizing with this customer in a lot of interesting ways, some of which take advantage of products we've developed, some which will take us into arenas we haven't yet hit into. Another sort of noteworthy item to talk about is that we are always submitting new proposals. There's a constant flow of opportunities, and we're constantly reviewing that and submitting proposals with the team. And we have one interesting one, which couples the physical marking of the DNA that we've done well, and now it brings in digital DNA, which then provides an end-to-end supply chain transparency solution. And that's something that is of importance for both corporates who are establishing best practices, as well as for government agencies and regulatory bodies who are developing standards, policies, and regulations based on that transparency. So a lot of what you're seeing in the room plays into this arena, and hopefully a lot of our customers will play into the work that our colleagues are doing.
Now I know how the page turner feels for the classical pianist. The pressure is enormous. Anyway, thank you, Janice. And several members of Janice's remarkable team are at the stations in the back. I hope you'll take a moment to see them. Now, the supply chain model converts development and pilot projects to recurring revenue across our portfolio and our products, services, and systems. Our work in DoD, supply chains with electronics, silicone gaskets, and bearings, served us well with a foundation to expand to a global scale and complexity that can sometimes be hard to imagine. One of our main contributors has been textiles, first with cotton, next with polyester for automotive and apparel and other contracts that are in early stages. Man-made fibers represent a significantly larger market than cotton, so we are quite pleased to be diversifying our textile markets. Now, this video portrays the process we use to tag cotton at the gym.
Pimacot is the world's only Pima cotton, verified from crop to consumer through a groundbreaking DNA tracking system. When we receive our cotton from the farms, we first use fiber typing, a patented DNA genomic test to make sure that all the cotton is in fact extra long staple Pima. We then mark our pure Pima cotton with Signature T, a proprietary botanical-based DNA marker that's engineered to bond to cotton at a molecular level, creating a permanent and unique signature. Applied during the ginning process, Signature T enables us to verify that our Pima stays pure across the supply chain. So the Pima we grow is the Pima you get. Pimacot, the new standard in Pima purity.
Now we no longer need cotton pilots. As we expand our cotton market, we've established ourselves quite well at some significant volumes, as you'll see. As the textile supply chains are the most dispersed across the globe and serve the broadest market, and with fast fashion driving incredibly short development times,
Textiles are truly large commercial ecosystems. Here to tell you about them is Mei-Lin Wang, one of our first employees and possessed of a stunning business sense and domain knowledge of textiles. Mei-Lin?
For textiles, our business development and sales program is centered on our supply chain certainty program. Some of the key revenue drivers include adding margins, volume of cotton tagged, as well as the number of supply chain entities to whom we sell DNA equipment and services, all of which have increased every year for the last three ginning seasons. In addition, all of the cotton tagging, testing, and traceability services are captured in our digital DNA textile portal, which provides valuable information on where the cotton comes from and also where it is going. Revenue leverage is highly evident in this market. From one manufacturer of finished goods came two retail champions for pull-through, giving us steady business baseline for many years forward. As supply chain partners have been recruited to fulfill this demand, they too are bringing new retail opportunities into our ecosystem. This is a great view we wanted to share with you. It shows the growth and diversity of cotton tanning. It is growing by leaps and bounds from 2014 with 5 million pounds tagged to 30 million in 2015 with Pimacot, as well as the introduction of homegrown tagging. Finally, in 2016, we tagged 120 million pounds of cotton. And we have expanded the homegrown program to include Acala, Lone Star, Delta, providing a wider range of qualities that allow for a broader assortment of products to be made. Also in 2016-2017, our tagging of organic cotton, which has great consumer pull. You may have also already been able to try some of the Pimacot and homegrown bed sheets that are already in the stores here in the US, and we expect more press coverage and adverts coming out throughout the year. It's exciting, and we hope that you will support Pimacot and homegrown products as they get launched in the stores this year and beyond. With regard to authentications, we've made great strides in signature T authentications, where customers have really seen an immediate value in tagging, testing, and traceability. Customers that were only 30% compliant became fully or 100% compliant after tagging. To date, we've seen an increase of up to over 2,000 tests in just one of our supply chains, and it continues to grow. It really demonstrates the leverage of increasing our mark universe. Finally, we are very pleased with the direction of the synthetic textiles business, which started with tagging finishing treatments to PET, with continued organic growth in exciting new projects. We have much more growth in this area in tagging man-made fibers, PET, as well as recycled PET, and we look forward to sharing our progress with you throughout the year. Thank you.
Thank you, Mei-Lin. Mei-Lin's colleagues are also at their station, to my right, toward the back, where you can feel finished goods made with Pimacot. Now, just last week, we had identified biomarkers on a cotton cultivar grown only in Uzbekistan. By identifying Uzbek cotton genomes, we can help restrict trade in cotton that enslaves people. We will do our best to ensure that this technology ultimately benefits the people of Uzbekistan. I know I can speak for all of us, employees and shareholders alike, when I say our most gratifying work is when we can protect humanity, when we can truly make life real and safe. Now, from the first day I encountered the Applied DNA platform, I, along with the management team, have anxiously awaited the opportunity to apply our platform to the elimination of counterfeit drugs, which cause a difficult or impossible to measure impact on both mortality and morbidity annually across the globe, and it just worsens. That possibility to have that impact became ever nearer when we were able to convince this next gentleman to join the team. Bob McLaughlin joined us after 23 years as an executive at Pfizer. He's an accomplished author, his network is amazing, and his domain knowledge is really a spinal reflex. Bob?
Morning, everyone. The pharmaceutical market continues to excite us for, number one, for deploying our molecular tagging into the marketplace for on-dose pharmaceuticals. What that does is to help companies reduce risk and uncertainty, and then, for more importantly, as Jim mentioned, for patients to ensure that they're getting the authentic product. Joining here about 9 months ago, I've had a chance to understand the marketplace for the technology, as well as to start talking to companies and to start talking to organizations, and particularly pharmaceuticals, nutraceuticals, food, as well as personal care ingredients. And what we've done is we've learned four important things that might be important to share. The first is there's a rising tide in the pharmaceutical market, and that's called pharmaceutical serialization. Pharmaceutical serialization is essentially putting barcodes mandated as part of the FDA 2013 Drug Supply Chain Security Act. As part of that, serialization requires all manufacturers by November of this year to put 2D barcodes on the packaging. Now, what happens when you move the packaging away from the product? And so, therefore, our opportunity here is that to be able to go to companies and to talk about the importance of tagging the tablet or the capsule or the ink that imprints on the tablet or the coating to ensure patient safety. What that rising tide has done is to elevate in the mind of pharmaceutical executives, supply chain executives, that there's a need for greater security. This figure here, which basically says 65% of serialization executives believe that while serialization will increase security, more needs to be done to protect patients. So that's number one. That's very important. Pharmaceutical serialization is increasing the tide. I think we can take advantage of that, and more needs to be done to get it on dose, not just on the packaging. So that's number one. Second thing we learned is that seamless integration into large and complex ecosystems is the key. The pharmaceutical market, and as far as the supply chain is concerned, has suppliers, sub-suppliers, sub-suppliers, and many suppliers that are all around the world. And what we've learned is that rapid adoption, key to rapid adoption of our tagging and our system of tracking, tracing, and authentication, that gives certainty, the key is to be embedded into an already existing, validated, and approved partner that's part of that important ecosystem. We have active projects underway to ensure that our technology gets embedded into that system so we can take advantage and get rapid adoption. So that's, I think that's really important, what we learn. The third is we have to be agile while there are sudden shifts and opportunities in the marketplace. So there's two examples. Number one, earlier this year, January, in Japan, it was discovered a counterfeit of hepatitis, a very important hepatitis C drug that was discovered in the marketplace. And Japan, traditionally, is known as a very, very tightly controlled and secure system. What this demonstrates to us is that not everything is secure. And a system as secure as Japan, having a counterfeit sent shockwaves through the system. So what this does for us is to provide us an opportunity to get our, to raise awareness of our technology, to be available to companies that have that problem, and to be able to manage that effectively for them. So that's number one. Second, as Tony Benson mentioned earlier, we have been invited by a very large global pharmaceutical company to be invited to request to submit a tender and to provide our technology information into their offices for review to be able to utilize it in their products. So this sign tells us that we're being there's more awareness of our technology and that we're being invited, and it's a good measure and milestone of success for pharmaceuticals. And lastly, there's a rising sort of agreement and understanding in the U.S. of the need for anti-counterfeit technology in pharmaceuticals. The unfortunate opioid crisis, which many of us have heard about, they're affecting the American communities. There have been discovered certain counterfeits as respect to the opioid abuse in America. And so the FDA, the general public, patients, families, and consumers are starting to get awareness of the problem of counterfeits in America, and that's putting pressure on companies. So let me summarize. I believe that we have a tremendous opportunity for pharmaceuticals, nutraceuticals, personal care, and also in food in the U.S. to deploy our tagging very effectively, not only to help companies protect brands, differentiate market share, reduce risk, but ultimately, to be able to have patients get the medicine and take the medicine that was prescribed to them that's safe and effective. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob. Please be sure to visit Bob's stations on the left, where you will see some of our components for pharma and personal care. Now, DNA production has been gaining traction under the leadership of Brian Biscount, and it holds a very simple business model for us, but a very, very exciting one. It leverages our existing capacity to manufacture DNA and our team's expertise in PCR into sellable biotech products of their own right. We acquired our initial customers from Vandalia, whom we acquired about 18 months ago, and we are revalidating our product due to the change in manufacturing locations from West Virginia to New York. We will follow the same path with other customers already in our pipeline, and that is acting as a contract research organization, in the industry it's called a CRO, for product research, development, and validation. But then converting to ongoing production as a contract manufacturing organization, a CMO. We are in the process of becoming CGMP, that is, current good manufacturing processes that are required by the FDA in these markets, and just at the right time. The need for DNA production in a CGMP facility is growing aggressively. This can be used in medical diagnostics, the production of reagents and vaccines, and we have the most efficient, most cost-effective, and purest DNA manufacturing process available. No one else can do this. Finally, I would like to introduce our secret weapon, who manages much more than information, but is essential to our sales and operations. Judy Mara is a stalwart of Long Island's business women, a dedicated advocate for STEM education, and one of the finest mentors I have ever known. Judy will knit it all together for you.
Knitting. I don't know how to knit. Thank you. Well, as the other bookend to today's presentation, I would like to knit it together with more insight about our information platform that we've been kind of quietly developing over time from our biotech roots. And that information is one that guides our customers' decision-making, so it has a purpose. Years ago, Jim sparked the vision of it and the blueprint, and we've been executing to that ever since. Please don't misinterpret, though. We're not leaving our biotech roots behind, by any means. In fact, DNA as an information carrier is high capacity, forensic, secure, and future-proof, since it's synonymous with nature, and that's not going away anytime soon. Looking forward, DNA as a link between the physical and digital worlds is the key to the growing wave of cybersecurity, cyber-physical security, claims traceability, and verified authenticity, as I'll describe. Now, our platform began years ago with the first associates in the company as an access database to store our codes. And you can see from the demonstrations here in the room how our physical digital platform is now embedded in our government business, in our textiles business, in our security business, and there's more to come. We've been very focused in our platform development to prioritize enabling processes of our core customers, first and foremost, keeping in mind our master blueprint made up of four capabilities described by each of our business leads today. Some of these are complete, some are still in progress, and others are on our roadmap to revenue for the future. Now, if you permit me to use the lingo of the IT industry, I'll describe these four areas. Number one is the identity of things. This is our marked universe that Maylin spoke about, tagging and authentication. You know the numbers. We marked over 750,000 microcircuits. We scaled our business so that now we're shipping 25,000 vials, unique asset marking kits per year. We produce enough DNA to mark 1 million pounds of synthetic fiber per month and 150 million pounds of cotton to date. Our genotyping identification services are second to none for processed goods. All of these are identity data that we store and work with. Number two is the Internet of Things, IoT. Or you may have heard of the Industrial Internet of Things, which is IIoT. These are smart machines communicating data to a place where it can be useful and insightful. Today, we have over 60 companies who have contributed data to our digital internet cloud-based platform, including 7 cotton gin marking systems, providing 49 data points, real-time, every minute, with monitoring connected to 20 separate alarms. If you think about it, when these are running simultaneously, as they do during the ginning season, that's 494,000 data points every day. Separately, our industrial mass-scale DNA production machines are internet accessible. Together, these systems set us up to do business anywhere in the world. They minimize the cost of our support, and they provide data for system security, production forecasting, billing of our customers, and the beginnings of supply chain tracking. Number three, intelligence from data and information. Not only is our platform accumulating what could be called big data from our own sources, but the digital platform is designed for data sharing, a critical attribute in supply chain or other commercial ecosystems. We'll continue to extract more intelligence from more points using more types of data entry over the course of an item's life cycle, through its travels in a supply chain. We're going to accomplish this through customer-specific development funding, by forming complementary partnerships for full solutions, and by continuing our own prototyping of emerging initiatives such as blockchain, which is transforming supply chain ecosystems at this point, smartphone capabilities, smart tags, and others that enable our customers. Last, number four, is our services business. This just means making applied DNA easy to do business with. It's the full solutions of products, services, services, support, and consulting that my colleagues described today. It lets our customers focus on their business operations. These capabilities add up to one thing for our customers and their customers, and that's certainty. Using identity, information, intelligence, we deliver trust, transparency, and traceability for our customers. And our purpose above all, as Jim mentioned, is to do good in the world by keeping life real and safe. So I'll turn it back to Jim at this point.
Okay, thank you, Judy, for your guiding vision and for steering our ship. I'd like to thank all those who participated in assembling this day for us, John Sherman, John Davis, Heather Berry, Jesse Hayward, Tom Ackerman, Gordon Hope, Larry Kick. We're also extremely grateful to the members of our board, our directors, and our strategic advisory board for their active guidance and mentorship. And to the shareholders for your continued faith. Thanks for your attention, and we're now open for questions. I think we'll have a mic in the middle, and my colleagues will join me, and we'll answer as many questions as we can. Don't be shy.
Got a question about synthetic marketing. At a previous meeting, there was a remark made that the growth curve could be similar to what we saw in cotton. In cotton, we saw 5 million to 40 million pounds in the first year, then to 120. So there's like an 8-fold increase and a 4-fold increase. In synthetics, it looks like you're projecting about 15 million for the year, which is about a 3-fold increase from last year. So the growth curve has not been the same as cotton. Are we expecting that to stay the same, or can we see that increase and kind of match?
Right. The curve you saw was for single synthetic man-made fiber, and that was PET. But the world's intention to adopt a circular economy is putting a huge emphasis on recycled materials, to reuse them, repurpose them. So we expect to see recycled versions of many fibers. But beyond PET, and there's also nascent PET, which we also have begun to mark. But there are many other fibers, rayon, polypropylene, polyethylene, a whole host of other polyesters. And we are exploring all of those. So you're seeing just one small fragment of that marketplace in that figure. But it's a good representative of how quickly we can grow across many.
Thank you.
Another question, that was a good one?
Yeah, but just a bit,
sir.
I can't hear a little bit because I was trying to find your meeting at the 50 Health Science Center.
Yes.
Anyway, a couple of questions. One, I think that the stock market is in for trouble because it's being manipulated. And the best way for you to fight it is to come up with some real earnings. And I was just wondering when you're going to do that. And I might have missed how you're doing with the other stuff before the cop. What's your most important product that's going right now as a money maker? I'll sit down. Thank you.
Okay, sure. Good questions, and I'm sure they're on the minds of everybody, myself included. And so we feel a huge pressure for the transition to profitability. You can be sure that your management team eats, works, and sleeps the notion. We're optimistic at the response of the marketplace. We see ourselves engaged with larger and larger firms, more and more Fortune 100s. We see ourselves having to do fewer and fewer pilots so that the uptake rate is faster, the sales cycle is becoming shorter. We see that we don't have the challenge of early adopters any longer, but have kind of crossed the chasm, if you know the model, and are getting inquiries from more and more companies. Now, we're a disruptive platform, so it does not happen instantly or overnight. But we're encouraged by the direction that we're going in, and you know, fingers crossed, I'm very bullish. More questions?
In the
synthetic slide, we gave projections out to 2017, but I don't recall seeing that for cotton. Can you give any guidance with respect to what we expect?
No, our habit up until now has to not give guidance, so we certainly wouldn't give guidance on the basis of rough estimates. We do when we have contractual basis for arriving at our numbers. And in cotton, that's a seasonal business. The yield from the farmers changes from year to year. The fashion 6 months from now, when the orders are really placed, could be different. And the factors driving the utilization of cotton may change. The demand for DNA tagged cotton we expect will continue to rise because the problems of substitution, of slavery within the supply chain, those are not going away. We've shown that when we recruit a brand who provides the pull at the end of the supply chain, that we're able to fix their problems very, very quickly over the course of just a period of a few months. So we're getting lots of inquiry, but we're not yet at the stage where we would be willing, nor would my lawyers be willing for us to provide guidance at this stage.
Okay. Second question, I apologize, I got here 10 minutes late, so I'm not sure how many of the board members are here.
All but one.
Okay, so my only general question is, I'm a longtime shareholder. Unfortunately, my average price is far higher than the share price today, and it seems to be an attractive time to buy. And one thing you look at companies, the conviction of the board. And the board, to my knowledge, for the most part, has not been purchasing company stock. Well, and I'd like to ask the members, why would that be? Because sure, that is a lot of high-performing companies. You see this, and it gives you a lot more faith as a shareholder.
Sure, I understand that completely, but what you said is not quite true.
So I'd like them to tell me what they've done, because it should be public
knowledge. Well, I'll tell you for them. So a couple of board members, myself included, have been in prior fundraising rounds, active leaders in those rounds. So that in terms of skin in the game, I'm the single largest individual shareholder, not through options, through shares I've acquired. And so I've stood behind the company, as have board members, and I'm proud of that. And I think our pattern is still exemplary. It doesn't happen with every race, but it does happen.
But outside, I mean, clearly, obviously, you're wed with this. You can see with the number of shares that you have, regardless of buying in the various issuances. But the remaining board, the board that doesn't work for the company, there hasn't been, to my knowledge, a lot of purchases. Their holdings are primarily what they've been paid, so to speak.
Yes, well, those are individual decisions.
And that's why I'm here to ask them if they could answer the question. So, just to think it's a valid question, no?
It's a question. I'm not certain it's a valid question because the board has participated, as I indicated all along, from the very, very beginning. And they are significant shareholders as a whole. The board represents a large portion of the outstanding shares.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Insurance companies are glad to see that type of work, A. And B, is there any pull from insurance companies to protect supply chains where they have obligations where a company like ourselves might be an element of helping them deal with their own liabilities?
Yes, I think that's an excellent question because I have always viewed insurance as kind of the pinnacle of the evolution of our customer base. And so in the case of Europe, the largest insurer in Scandinavia, really provoked the program and was satisfied that the payout was significantly diminished. Their annual payout per customer, per insured, was significantly diminished to justify increasing and enhancing the program. And when the automobile distributors and importers began to see that happen, they wanted a piece of that action. And so that story is continuing to evolve with new countries engaged, new brands involved, and we intend to pursue that model very aggressively. And that is relevant to far beyond the automotive industry as well, you know, home assets, casualty and property as well.
Jim, you announced the end of two DoD contracts over the last 12 months, but we haven't heard anything about either ongoing activities or things in the pipeline. Are you able to speak about any of that?
Sure. DoD, you can join me too, Jonathan. First of all, you can poke me if I start to say something I shouldn't, and if you can say something better, you're more than welcome to. But those contracts had scheduled endpoints, so they stopped on schedule. We were very successful in the completion of those contracts. What the contracts called for were recruitment after the close of the RIF of commercial parties who will generate product DNA tagged both for the military market as well as for COTS, which is a very important part of their program. So we've been very successful with several applications. We're broadening that application base. And we currently have additional contracts that would extend those observations and the applications under consideration.
It might be worth noting that the reports for the RAF contract and the SBIR contracts were submitted back in the fall. And those contracts are being reviewed. So all the results are currently being reviewed, and in government time, a few months is barely a blink. At the same time, in parallel, we are working and hosting meetings with some of the companies that worked with us through the trial periods. In addition, we're working with some of the agencies so they can see how they would be able to take the programs we have in place and possibly replicate those in other supply centers. So it's sort of the trifecta of things happening in tandem.
Any other questions?
Sounds like some good things are going on, Jim. As always, you're working hard to advance the technology further. My question is really around, as you move the needle forward with the new technologies, you have cash in the bank, you have accounts receivable, and a cash burn situation that you're balancing. Mm-hmm. Are you projecting another raise, and if so, how far out?
At this time, we're not projecting publicly another raise. We have a substantial accounts receivable. We have deferred revenue we have not yet recognized. And we have a large pipeline. So we're very sensitive to the issue. Sensitive to the value of our share price and the timing of anything we might do in the future. But at this stage, we're laser focused really on execution and raising our revenue rate.
Just one last question for me, if you don't mind. It's more for Bob. I'm wondering if you can comment. I know you can't comment specifically on what contracts might be coming up, but what's your personal kind of goal? What's the next step? Are we looking at a pilot project? Are we trying to get a big contract right away? And what kind of timeline do you personally think is vital to reach.
So you mentioned a couple of things, large contract, timeline. So I'll give you two points with respect to that. I think the first, and I highlighted this in my presentation, is it's really important to be a trusted and valued partner that's part of an ecosystem. Pharmaceutical companies for the last 20 years have created this massive, complex, and very rigid ecosystem because they're forced to. Right, with the FDA, with the rules and regulations from governments to governments around the world. It's the most heavily regulated industry on the planet, bar none. And so that system is in place. So what's really important for us is to see that system, recognize it, and instead of fighting it, to join it. Right? So that's really important, is to be part of that system. And I alluded to two projects that we have underway to become part of that system, to be embed our technology as part of that system. So that's the first step, is to be part of that system so that it's easier for pharmaceutical company customers to be able to make a seamless transition. The idea of a massive industry diverting completely and saying, well, you know, we're gonna try this, is very challenging, but when you have an established system that you're part of, the rapid adoption becomes faster. So that's the first clue. The second is that the contracts, if you will, the approach to the pharmaceutical companies is twofold. The first is the area of product differentiation. Increasingly, companies want to be able to differentiate their product in the marketplace with respect to hospital tenders and other businesses. So we're looking at that market as a way to differentiate the product. Not necessarily about supply chain protection, but it's about product differentiation, enhancing patient safety. The second part of it is we are looking at tenders, such as the ones Tony mentioned, which are these very short-term, sudden opportunities that come up, whether it's a accounting problem in a country or a company invites us to participate, or we see an opportunity and we are agile enough to be able to do that. So the short answer to your question is yes, yes, and yes. We're trying to become part of the system. We're responding and becoming more agile to very short-term opportunities. You know, and then the third is we are working with large companies to be able to have longer term relationships with them. So I hope that answers some part of your question. Thank you.
Any other questions? And if not, I'd like to take the opportunity again to thank you all for coming and invite you to have a close look around at all the stations in the room and meet some of our other colleagues. Thank you very much.